long way. And any engine's booked.
Absolutely. I'm sure they've just split the pit stops up to allow the guys to get in separately, to not have any altercation in the pits. But the captain's got different strategies before. A lot of times they work, so we might learn something here.
Well, he gets to the end of the yellow. If he holds him out a long time, then he gives him a little longer run on whatever tires he puts.
Yeah, it's definitely raining. It's starting to rain more and more.
When he comes in, by the way, this will give the lead over to Sharp, followed by Sarah Fisher and Felipe Giafone. In third place. Here is that situation with George Mack.
As you can see, as they're running through there, he probably looked in the mirror and saw Sam Hornish coming up through. Looked like he was trying to give him a little bit of space to let him go underneath him, and probably gave him too much room because he was well off the black area where you want to run in the groove, and he was actually up into the gray area.
Firestone tires that they're using here this weekend are the same that they used at Phoenix. Pretty hard compound, but you can still see some marbling now beginning to develop just off the line.
As we go through here, watch to see what's happening. Sam Hornish's car is right down here in the groove. George Mack is up here. This gray area here is just about the maximum where you want to be as you start to go through the turn. As we start to run, you'll see that George Mack is up into the gray. The front starts to push, and the car is going to get up here into what we call the marbles and end up just getting a sliding car going up into the wall, almost like quickstand. It will just suck you up into the wall, and he has no control of the car right now, and it will just go up there and graze the wall. He was trying to be polite, trying to help Sam Hornish, but he paid the price.
Paul, we've got a quick update from the pit area. Maybe the reason Roger Penske is keeping DeFerrin out is because it is now sprinkling hard. It's not the little ice pellets that we saw before, although there are a handful of those, but maybe he's just gambling that maybe this race is close to a point where they may not be able to continue if it gets a lot more wet.
Well, Gary, if that's true, it's quite a gamble, because you would think that that car is beginning to go very, very dry. Because of the rain, IRL Control said we're going to keep it under yellow a little bit. And we're about to find out how far the Penske Chevrolet engine is going to be able to go.
Paul, that's a very good point. One of the things that a lot of the teams and engine builders, specifically the Chevrolet engine builders, have been telling me is that under caution and in that configuration, they are able to conserve so much fuel. There was some talk that if there was enough cautions here at Nazareth, that they could go as much as 100 laps.
Whoa.
Between pit stops.
86 laps since DeFerrin last stop. He could potentially go 100. Sarah Fisher will take over second, assuming a stop by Jill DeFerrin. That's Infinity Power. Subbing for Robbie Buell. So still under caution at Nazareth.
185 laps completed. It is raining here at Nazareth. Will they red flag the race soon? Well, we're just going to have to wait to find out, but certainly Roger Penske might hope that, because one of his drivers is up front, Gary.
Yes, in the pits, you can see the raindrops bouncing off the Hugo Boss outerwear. Roger, how long can you gamble here hoping that this race ends? I assume that's what you're hoping for.
Well, I think that, you know, we can run quite a bit longer, and obviously with the yellows we've had and with the weather like this, there was, you know, really wasn't a chance to come in or don't come in, but we'll just have to wait and see. I think the longer this weather is doubtful will give us play into our hands.
Can you lobby hard, or is that totally out of your hands?
I don't think I can lobby over here.
Remember the man whose headquarters is just about 35 miles away in Reading, Pennsylvania. He's got more time with his drivers at this track than anybody else around. They're looking for a possible seventh win at Nazareth.
This is, of course, Roger Penske's first year in the Indy Racing League, but we're certainly happy to have him in the league. And his team has certainly been very, very strong here in the first four races of the year. And if it continues the way it is right now, this could be the second victory for Marlboro Team Penske. Well, Thomas Schechter was eliminated earlier in a crash, but the Yamaha fastest lap of the race was turned in by Schechter. That happened on lap number 82, and it was a lap at 167.202. Buddy Lazier was also eliminated in a crash. He has the second fastest lap of the afternoon. Sam Hornish has moved up to 19th position now because he is out there and picking up laps. He is up to 19th now, but it certainly will be a loss of the points lead for Sam Hornish, or at least it will tighten the points lead up very, very tightly as we go to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Sarah Fisher is running in third spot. Now remember, she's substituting for Robbie Buell, and she was involved with a bit of an incident earlier in the race. She touched tires with another car, but she was able to keep going and has persevered from the 19th starting position and is currently running in third. And I'm sure she and the Dryan Reinbolt team, Purex team, also hopes that perhaps the red flag will come out and this race will be called. Scott Sharp is running in the second position. Giafone is fourth. Elio Castroneves is fifth, and so Marlboro Team Penske now has the first and fifth place drivers. A great run for Alex Barron, who is shown in sixth position, and also a great run for Sam Schmidt and Anthony Lazzaro as they are currently in the seventh spot. Eddie Cheever eighth, Boat ninth, and Hattori is 10th. And for those of you tuning in to ABC Sports, stay tuned because the EA Sports Supercross will be shown in its entirety as soon as we finish up this race. And the status is that we are under caution, 188 out of 225 laps completed, and the caution is because of a crash involving George Mack, but that incident was cleaned up a while ago. Really, the reason for the caution at the moment is because of the light rain that is continuing to fall here at Nazareth. It has sporadically throughout the day, never enough to cause a major dampening of the track, but just enough to keep the cars from at top speed. On board with Scott Sharp, who is currently in second position. And Scott Goodyear, maybe we can talk with this gentleman with whom we ride.
Scott Sharp, Scott Goodyear in the booth. Can you hear us?
Yes, Scott.
Looks like some of that Kelly strategy has paid off for you today.
Tom and all the guys have just done a great job. You know, real team effort today. We hung in there and kept improving the car. And, you know, just got to see what happens here. You know, I think the track can be pretty good as long as the rain holds off. But it just, when it's spitting, it's sort of in a bit of an unknown.
Well, if we go back to green, good luck.
Very much.
Scott Sharp currently in second position, down to Gary Gerald.
Well, we're on this medical patrol, it seems, and here's George Mack out of the medical center. You appear to be all right. We watched the replay. You got up there awful high into the gray stuff, and there's just no saving grace. You couldn't hang on to it at all, huh?
Oh, no, not at all. This track is not forgiving at all. But we're pretty quick, you know, because we qualified very well. But unfortunately, 310 Giovanna Carr just has a hard time adhering to the surface. It's really cold.
Yeah. It's really cold. And hopefully it'll be a whole lot warmer next month at Indianapolis. I know you're excited about that. We wish you well.
Yeah, I'm really excited. Thanks. All right.
He ran 2:22 in ROP, Bob, at Indy. Got to keep an eye on.
Very well. Yeah, in rookie orientation, we expect big things from him. We'll return with more of the Firestone Indy 225 after a word from our ABC stations. Coverage of the 86th running of the Indianapolis 500 begins on Saturday, May the 11th at 1 o'clock Eastern Time, as we'll have pole day as they run for the front starting spots in the Indy 500. Then bump day on Sunday, May 19th, that's at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. We determine the fastest 33. And don't forget, of course, the Indianapolis 500 itself, which will be on at 11 o'clock Eastern Time, Sunday, May the 26th, the 86th. Greatest spectacle in racing live on ABC. We hope to go back to racing here in a few moments. The IRL officials are studying the situation and they believe that the track is in good enough shape to go back to green flag racing. We're at the 193 lap mark out of 225, and again, that is Jill DeFerrin at the front of the field. DeFerrin last pitted on lap 95. And we are on lap 193 right now, so he has gone almost 100 laps. Some of those, of course, under caution since he pitted. And Scott Sharp last pitted on lap 27 along with Sarah Fisher. Giafone on 137, and Castroneves pitted relatively recently on lap 178 during this caution period.
Bob, we just got a radio call there from Al Unser Jr. He was telling his crew it's still very slippery out here, so that's something to keep in the back of the mind, too. And as you indicate, the Penske team's running out of time here as far as DeFerrin is concerned and fuel. Jack?
Well, Gary, remember one thing, you know, when we talk about fuel consumption, what about the Ilmor teams? And I use the plural. Your leader, Ilmor, is their engine, the Chevy assembler. Well, Scott Sharp, who runs in second, Tom Kelly is also a partner with Roger Penske in the Ilmor team. I think with the fuel consumption that Team Penske is getting, if I was Tom Kelly, I'd want to find out what was in that Ilmor that got delivered to Reading, Pennsylvania.
If we keep picking up pace car speed.
There have been four leaders in this race. Jill DeFerrin has led the most laps, 58. Al Unser Jr. has led 54, Castro Neves 51, and Sharp 32. We have had six caution periods for 105 laps. So almost a half of this race is being run under the caution. And again, remind you that this EA Sports Supercross Texas Stadium will be coming up next here on ABC at the conclusion of this race.
Bob, I'm just wondering, what does Roger Penske do now? He's right on the tip of the pyramid. Does he try and stay out and not give up any track position? You know he has to stop. You know they're going to try and go green. So is the best bet to bring the car in now as fast as you can? Get it a splash of fuel to go the last few laps, not a full load, and then hope that he can whiz his way through traffic.
Well, given the weather situation that we have had here today, that is sprinkles, but not enough to dampen the track, it would seem that he would have to come in here, get a splash, because I quite honestly think this race is going to go the distance, and we're only 28 laps away from that right now. Gary?
Well, Bob, we're trying to find out down here in the Penske cap, because it's now 102 laps since they were last in the pits for fuel, how much longer they can go. They're playing everything, obviously, very, very close to the vest. We wouldn't expect anything different from the captain and his crew, but there is no indication whatsoever yet of these guys. I mean, the body language doesn't say, hey, we're about to pounce over the wall and try to fuel this car before we go green.
Well, Gary, very interestingly, this we see here that 68 of the 100 laps that Jill has run so far have been underneath a yellow caution period. So we know there might be some fuel in the tank to go quite a few more laps under yellow. The big gamble will be, when do we go green, and will there be enough fuel in there to run those green flag laps? Obviously, Scott Sharp is certainly hoping that that is not the situation. We know we probably have another 3, 4, possibly 5 laps to go before we're going to go back to green. And what is actually happening right now is that the IRL is assessing each individual turn to see if it is dry enough. They're speaking to the turn workers and to the officials on those turns to see if their track in front of them is dry enough to go back to green.
Scott, one of the predicaments that Scott Sharp will find himself in is the running order out on the racetrack. They've been talking on the radio about the fact that it's one of his teammates, Al Unser Jr., directly in front of him, and in front of him, the Airlink car of rookie Ricky Treadway. Under normal circumstances, Scott Sharp could stab and steer quickly on the restart, but they've determined they want to let the tires come up to heat. So they've told Scott to be very conservative at the drop of the green flag and try and initiate the passes as long as maybe 2 or 3 laps after green.
That sounds like a good plan. At least 5 laps, maybe 10, before you get proper tire temperature, which would be your maximum tire temperature for today, which still is well below the usual that they would see on a Firestone situation. We talked about 80 to 100 degree of ambient temperature to get a good track temperature up over 100. We're not seeing that here today. All these guys are gonna have to be very cautious on the restart. We look here at the track conditions. The wind has actually changed since we started this morning. The wind speed of 5 miles an hour is not an issue right now. It's the air temperature and the track temperature, probably 30, 40 degrees below what we would expect to see here right now. All these drivers know they only have a few laps left coming up here to the finish, and they certainly don't want to make a mistake. They're after championship points, but they also don't want to cause a lot of work for their team if they have an accident coming up to the Indianapolis 500.
There are 11 cars currently on the lead lap. Al Unser Jr. is the next car not on the lead lap. He's running in 12th position. Then Robbie McGee, and race control still has not decided on a green flag. So we continue to run under the caution here. And again, Sam Hornish now moves up to 18th position. He is 49 laps back of the leader due to that incident early on in the race.
As we're under caution, Bob, it's very interesting to look at all the spotters up here on the roof beside our television booth, each talking to each other, trying to make some plans about what's going to happen here in the next little while. And that doesn't happen just at the very front. It also happens all the way through the people in the middle of the pack or the back of the pack. Everybody's looking for points here.
Word is from race control, we will go green in two more laps.
And Scott Sharp may be getting a bit of a break. The report given to Scott is that Rick Treadway, one of the cars between himself and the leader, may be pitting this time around. If that unfolds, then the only car separating himself from the leader would be his teammate, Al Unser Jr. They have already discussed the possibility of Sharp being able to initiate a pass in turn three. You just saw Treadway pull onto pit road, and we're getting ready for the green.
Less than 23 laps until the checkered flag comes out, and again, you'll see Supercross in its entirety at the conclusion of this event.
Bob, I'm told that they're going to let, they pulled the pace car off, and they're going to let DeFerrin set the pace to try to determine how wet it is and how fast they can go.
The pace has picked up here, but we are not under green. We're just checking the racetrack, testing
it. Okay, we're not going here, guys. We're going to keep this pace a minute. Just stay like this, Jill. Just stay what you're doing. Just keep going like that.
That first voice you heard was Brian Barnhart, the chief steward for this event, speaking directly to Jill, letting him know that it will not be a green flag. And there's probably some radio communication going on right now from Jill to his vehicle, directly to Brian Barnhart, getting the results of what's happening on the racetrack.
We're going to get ready to go here in a minute. I'm going to let the 55 go back around you and put him in the back of the field.
The yellow and black car of Rick Treadway you just saw go past the Marlboro car of DeFerrin. The reason that was done is that he went into the pit, had a pit stop, came back out, was in the middle of all those cars, and they let him go back around, pick up a lap.
Now there are just 20 laps to go, so when the green does come out, we're going to have a shootout to the finish. When they come around, the drivers will be given the pearl green flag, indicating one lap till we go back to racing. Again, the field is DeFerrin, then Sharp, then Fisher, Giafone, Castro Nevis, Barron, Lazzaro, Cheever, Boat, Hattori, and Dare. Those 11 cars on the lead lap. Now, Al Unser Jr. is the second car in line. You see his name to the right.
And Bobby's already told his teammate that we'll be able to pass him, be able to pass him.
They're coming to green on lap number 207, Paul.
Green. They are going to have to be so very careful as they come back to green. Full track, full tires. Wait for pressures to come up. Giafone moves on Sarah Fisher, almost gets trapped. Fisher gives him room. Giafone around Fisher. On the backstretch, shot. Sharp still behind his teammate, Al Unser Jr.
A great bold move by Giafone to go underneath their cold tires underneath Fisher in turn two.
13 laps since Jill DeFerrin has been in the pit.
Five on fuel.
DeFerrin still leads it.
Giafone in your mirrors.
Sharp looks like he's not quite up to the pace that he needs to be able to catch up to DeFerrin.
In your mirrors, looking inside.
Oh, Giafone crying the inside, getting trapped off.
Tell you, Giafone probably had his heart pump up about 20 more beats per minute. Now he's got to control himself, his emotions, and just start to get back up to pace and catch up to Sharp again and have another run at him.
When you do something like that, you get committed, then you lose momentum. And you've got to get the car rolling again. So Giafone drops back. Sharp finally gets Al Unser Jr. 210 laps are now complete, 15 to go.
Well, we heard that Sharp was going to wait a few laps to make sure the tire temperatures came up, the pressures came up. Certainly has done that, and that is a smart move on his part.
Hey, guys, we just heard now that the message has been indicated to DeFerrin that he needs to get 2.2 miles per gallon to be able to go the distance. We talked to Tim Sindrick before the start of the race, asking about what kind of mileage you can make. He said, low twos. I said, said, can you go 2.2 in order to get 75 full laps under green? He said, yeah, we should be able to do that. If he can make 2.2, he may be able to make the distance.
Well, when you say that, let's not forget that Cheever ran out of fuel here back in 1995 with a lap and a half to go when he was driving for A.J. Foyt. They played the gamble, and it didn't work out.
Philippe Giafone now coming up again, trying to work on Scott Sharp. Sharp closing on DeFerrin. DeFerrin trying to save fuel. DeFerrin's in an awful position. He's got to save fuel, but he's also got to keep going fast. He's got to keep Sharp off of his back.
Absolutely. And what happened, Paul, is when you say save fuel, what they're doing is that they're making the engine run lean. Instead of running 100% fuel, pits are instructing him to make the engine run lean. 95% fuel. They give away 5% in a situation like that to try to make up some fuel mileage. Less horsepower is the result of doing something like that. Less speed on the racetrack. And this is why Sharp is probably starting to catch up to him.
Now just 10 laps to go. And can DeFerrin make it?
Here you go, Scotty.
And if he can't, can Scott Sharp hold off a charging Felipe Giafone, who can run with as much fuel as he likes right now?
The number for DeFerrin coming down, 2.15 is now necessary. So he's meeting the obligation, it appears, inside 10 to go.
Well, if there is any guy in the sport who knows how to drive on that razor edge, it is Gil DeFerrin. Technically, he's absolutely superb. Giafone closes on Sharp now. Battle's going to heat up for second here in a second.
Exactly what's happening now. Think Sharp has not had very good finishes all this year, has had a lot of bad luck, certainly looking at some points to get himself up in the points championship. Obviously wants to win this race, but he certainly doesn't want to have a situation where he gives away points.
And Sharp doesn't want to run up too close on DeFerrin. He wants a little space, so if he can take a run on him, he needs that distance. But at the same time, he's got a quandary going, because he's got to keep Felipe Giafone totally off of his back, and that's a problem for him as well.
You see, he fell back a little bit there, and now he's on the gas. Looks like he's having trouble right there in turn two. You can hear him playing with the throttle.
Five to go.
You hear his team telling him five laps to go. He gets a good run going into three, and then he has a shot coming out of here going up to one. He needs a good run all the way up through one and two to get him going down through into turn three, which is the best passing place. You can see here from the Firestone information, still doing 170, 72 miles an hour in the turns. It's a quick, quick pace to this late race stage.
Firestone telemetry is so cool. Too bad it doesn't give us fuel mileage.
Well, we got information from the teams, Paul. I'm not sure they tell it to us.
Sharp right up on DeFerrin now. 221 laps complete. If you're sitting in this car, Scott Sharp, you're looking at the leader ahead, you're looking at him closing on traffic. What do you do?
Well, he's hoping that the car in front of him looks like it was Rick Treadway. They'll catch up to them very quickly. It will slow down DeFerrin. He might be able to get a run on him, but you have to hope it happens at the right place on the racetrack, because this is a one-line racetrack, very difficult to pass, which we've seen all day. Sharp gets very wide. I would say the Sharp's car right now has probably got a little bit of push, a little bit of understeer. The front of the car is not responding quite as well as he needs it to in traffic. He gets a run at DeFerrin, and he gets close, and then he seems to lose that front end.
Treadway moves to the side. Gil DeFerrin comes around. His car's got to be running on fumes. Coming to the white flag next time around for Gil DeFerrin. Sharp is there. He knows he's out of time now. If he's going to pass him, it's going to have to be in turn three of this lap. Sharp closes.
He's up.
Sharp goes around.
We said that just a moment ago. The same situation happened with Cheever back in 1995. And you have to say Scott Sharp drove a smart race, didn't get too excited. He could have overdrove the car to try to catch up to Gil DeFerrin, but he played it smart.
Not your fault, Gil. You did everything you could. Seventh career win for Scott Sharp.
Hey, Scott Sharp. Scott Goodyear in the booth. Did you read us?
Got you guys. Boy, I just don't know what to say. Thank the Lord above for just an incredibly safe day. Really watched out for us and put all my faith in him. But Tom Kelly and the Delphi team just did awesome, pissed off, kept us in the race. Yeah!
Well, the luck that you guys have had this year, you certainly deserved it. A nice, smart drive. Congratulations.
Scott.
There's no better feeling, guys, than going around knowing that you won the race and just looking for victory circle.
And that failure on the last lap by DeFerrin gave the points lead back to Sam Hornish. It's running that tight.
That Whoa. Tight. And that would have been the first time since the beginning of 2001, excuse me, that Sam Hornish would not have been in the points lead if that was Jill DeFerrin winning the race today. So that's an incredible.
Pole sitter last year in the 85th Indy 500. The 86th Indy 500 is next. You're going to see it right here on ABC. What does that do for Scott Sharp in terms of driving him into Indy?
Well, it certainly takes some momentum here because he's had such a rough time this year, and I'll tell you that they've got the momentum now.
Gary Gerald.
I'm glad this is, you're thinking you're glad you weren't in Atlantic City, but it's got to be crushing to come oh so close, Roger.
Well, we saw a fuel dropout on the back straightaway, and, you know, he was making fuel. We were in good shape, but, you know, we're a couple turns from being there. Obviously, that's what it's all about. Well, we finished third. Both cars finished. We're helps us in the points with Hornish having a problem. So at the end of the day, that's what makes racing.
And you go on to Indianapolis. If you were at Indy, you'd make the same gamble?
Got to make the gamble every time, but you know, what can I say? It was both cars did a job. We had a tough pit stop here at one point, got us a little bit behind, but hey, everybody has a strategy here and they all used it.
Thank you, Roger. Jack?
Well, one man that made the right call, TK, Tom Kelly, you called the strategy for this guy.
Well, I'll tell you, I thought we were going to be out of luck there at the end, but you know, I just, Scotty kept pushing Jill, and he ran out of fuel with a half lap to go, man. Nice job.
Awesome job. These guys were great. Tom did a great job. Calling. It's the second race we won because of you, buddy. And I just got back to man above. We just kept the hammer down and really thought, you know, so hard to pass here. Really thought that was it. But I said, maybe he's going to run out one of these days. And all of a sudden, sure enough, right in front of me, and I just had to gas it and hope.
Let's talk real quick, though, Scott, about the teamwork from not only your teammate, Al Unser Jr., but also from the rookie, Ricky Treadway, because they got out of the way. They waited until your tires got up to temperature, but then you had a clear shot.
Al was great. You know, he really was. We working really well as teammates, and, you know, I guess I owe him one now, but, you know, both guys really let the leaders go for it, which was great.
All right, momentum is so important leading up to the Indianapolis 500. We've looked at your demeanor over the last couple of weeks, and it has changed considerably. You've got a score to settle there.
Yeah, I do. I mean, I'm excited. I can't believe it. I really thought we turned a corner when we came and tested here. Great test at Indy. Win here. We're ready to go to May.
Big Mo, so important, Gary Gerald, when Indy opens in just 10 days.
Well, you talk about momentum going into the month of May. Here's Philippe Giafone, who ends up in that second spot. What are you thinking as you're watching those two guys in front of you? How are you trying to play it for the last five laps?
I try everything I could in the beginning, you know, but then I had some, like, two very close calls, and I was in the grass for a little while. Look at the grass there. And I was concerned a little bit that upset the car for a few laps, but then for the last three laps, my car started to pick it up a little bit of push. And I knew the fight would be for Sharp, but at the end I said, maybe Gio is gonna go for it, you know? And he tried and ran out of gas, so I'm very happy.
I guess you are. We wish you well next month. We'll enjoy watching it, Indy.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right, Bob?
Philippe Giafone comes home second. Jill DeFerrin, third. Sarah Fisher, fourth. Then Cat.